Welcome everybody to the Monday, November 29th meeting of the Mayor's Blue Ribbon Energy Advisory Committee. Start by taking the roll. Commissioner Thompson, our committee member Thompson.
Yes, here.
Committee member Ben D'Antonio.
Present.
Committee member Allison Tanner, who will not be here tonight, but she sent us her input. Committee member Becca O'Brien will be joining us shortly. Parking lot on a call. Karen Connard is away. Peter Rice is here. Ritz is here. We have Kevin Charette.
I'm here. Can you hear me okay?
Yes, we can. That's great.
Right, thank you.
Tom Rooney. Yeah, excuse me. Remember Tom Rooney.
You missed one meeting.
My apologies.
Oh, no problem.
I'm glad you're here. And Becca. Next, we have public comment.
And I'm here too.
Yes.
I'm really just.
You're good.
No, I'm not after that.
Soft as a leaker.
Yes. Hey, John, I'm here too.
We will hope you live in quiet. So, public comment, we can go here. Anyone?
Just Kevin.
So, I thought we'd use tonight to sort of make sense of the presentations we had.
Excuse me, Mr. Chairman, can we just approve the minutes from, it's not on the agenda, but I think we need to do that officially,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
And I have a couple of questions to the rest of you. I wasn't quite sure who was joining us by Zoom last time. I think April Salas of Hanover joined us.
Correct.
And did Nate Walsh from Durham, was he here? Or did
he was here.
He was here. Okay.
Yeah, he's sitting next to me.
Okay, good. Thanks a lot. And then in the minutes, at some point, I wrote that some people were from the coalition were working without a salary. I think the proper terminology is at risk, on an at-risk basis. Correct. I think I read up in their business plan. That's how they referred to it in the business plan.
I understood that there were folks that weren't going to do at risk, but there were also the people that were working. They were volunteering their efforts.
Yeah, I didn't get that detail with the minutes. I just know that when I wrote not working for salary, when I looked at the business plan. They just say at risk.
Yep.
So that's the only correction I would suggest for the minutes.
Okay. On the minutes, yes. Mr. Rooney is a committee member, correct?
Yes.
Shouldn't he have the double asterisk?
Oh, no, because I wasn't there.
He wasn't here.
There. Okay.
Yeah.
He's in a list of attendance work.
Right, but it says symbol. If you're a member of the committee, you're in attendance with two stars.
Okay.
He wasn't here.
All right, under the presentation by Community Power, first bullet,
yep.
Third sentence, Mr. Golding and Mr. Belo highlighted the advantages of the coalition model. I didn't know if it would be better to say the portfolio manager model, coalition's version of the portfolio manager model.
Okay.
It's a little more clear. And then two sentences later, the coalition would be better able to navigate. I didn't know if that needed some kind of predicate, better than what? Better than something else is implied. I said no, it would be helpful to be clear about what it's better than.
This is just not verbatim, obviously.
Sure.
So I think they were just trying to highlight, they felt that what would you replace that with?
Maybe than the broker model, perhaps?
Okay, better than the broker model.
Or, if I may, or than a community acting on something. I think was part of the idea.
Community.
I look at it from our standpoint, it wasn't so much broker, but the navigating all these requirements and regulations is something that coalition provides better ability to deal with, and with a town, it's try and go power on time.
That sounds very, very good to me.
Standard powers fine with there, you know what I mean? Like that. But the community's vantage point, I think, is what I mean.
Sounds good. Those are my only questions.
Okay. Thank you very much. You know, it was like stretching.
Any other changes on the minutes? So a motion?
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
What I thought I'd do tonight was just go around the table and thoughts from each of you on what we are part of what our committee is doing. Should we move ahead with community power? Is it beneficial to our residents? And if so, how should we? We could even add when, but the how involves the presentations that we've seen. We've seen a couple of different ways. And then we were going to look back to the council on whether we should join CPC. So I'm just going to go around the table, and I may just jot some, capture some things as we go.
Your bricks will be hard. Talk to you about.
Yeah, I can. You want me to write it on here, or I can write it on the. I have a Word document.
Well, it's good to see him.
Yeah.
Visual. Lost about 3/4.
I know that problem with the screen, and the whiteboard. We can put it.
Right. Small. So, Becca, why don't we start with you?
Here.
And remind people to use the microphones so the recording captures our audio.
Sure. All right, where to start?
Just let it flow.
So, especially after, was it 2 weeks ago, when Samuel came to give the presentation on risk management? I kind of got a little bit lost in the weeds. It was amazing information, and all the resources and links he sent us were immense. But I found myself having to sort of go back to the conversation we had when we very first met as an advisory committee about what we were chartered to do. So I kind of wrote it all down to make sense of it in my head. John, I think I shared it with you, and I had a chance to speak with you, Tom, last week. Just put all my thoughts down on one piece of paper or two. So I know we were sort of chartered with Business a Coalition that we should join. And I know in the summer months, when some of these committee members had taken place in the summit that the coalition had put on, and then our Sustainable Initiatives Committee, we advised to do a work session. I think there were some of us that were feeling like, well, this is great. You know, especially after the work session, this sounds like a wonderful opportunity, and it made a lot of sense, a lot of benefits. So I know as an advisory committee, then we're sort of chartered to take a step back and say, as a city, should we actually join this coalition? So I know we sort of wanted to look at the status quo, okay, as a community that wants to look at maybe lowering rates for our ratepayers, or do we want to add on the benefit of finding distributed, cleaner power. Yes, that might be a priority for some of us, but maybe not for all of us. So it's kind of taking a step back and saying, okay, if we stay at status quo, could we do that? Perhaps not, and the coalition is an opportunity for us to, again, maybe get lower rates for the residents, and maybe look at cleaner local distributed power. And look at some of those enhancements to efficiency that I think we've all come to realize that might be a very important first step when we're looking at power and renewable sources and whatnot. So status quo, stay the same. The coalition model, the other model we looked at was the broker model, which is that sort of like it's a great service, but it's sort of a pay per kilowatt hour. And what I learned from the presentation from Good Energy and Standard Power was that while they might help us with lower rates, that and could they actually push for lower than default rates? There were some question marks around, could a Good Energy or Standard Power actually get us to a place where we're looking at energy transition, right? Could that type of model hit that kind of check mark for us as a municipality and as ratepayers? Could they kind of hit the check mark with helping us get that distributed or localized energy goals that I think this is me personally speaking. If I had to pick a menu of options, right, that would be one of them. And then could that broker model be actually looking at those sort of system enhancements, efficiencies? The big thing for me that's missing from the broker model was that shared knowledge and power that I think we get from the coalition, the transparency piece, the advocacy and helping shepherd through some of the legislative activities with the PUC, I think we might not get from the broker model. So I'm sorry, I'm kind of going between sort of benefits of the coalition and then sort of knocking some yeah. things off the list.
No, it's we're with you.
Okay, good. I think too, what I really struck me from our conversation a couple weeks ago with Sam Golding and then having Avery Salas from Hanover was just that amazing shared knowledge and experience. And something that really struck me was that Hanover did try and kind of go it alone for, I don't know, 8-10 years, something like that. So through this whole process, it's been great, and it's still leading me towards there are massive benefits from this community joining the coalition. I do have some areas of concern joining the coalition. I don't know if we want to go through that now, but there are not any risks or questions that would imply us not joining it. It's just questions I have. So I didn't know if you wanted to take it in two parts. Like, is the committee, are you going to advise city council that you should join? And then laying up, like, what might be sort of the next steps, the risks, the questions that our community might ask of us? I feel like it might be two separate.
Well, I think it's good to do the pros and the cons so that we have a balanced look and see some of those pitfalls. So yeah, you could speak to those.
Let me speak to them real quick now.
Yeah.
So
can I make a suggestion?
Yeah. Yes.
I think it'd be useful, and if people aren't ready to, that's fine. But I think it would be useful to hear from committee members their answers to the two questions that we were charged with. Should we pursue community power? Should we join the coalition? And then I think all the other pieces are helpful,
yeah.
But I think it would be interesting. And again, if you're like, I'm not really sure yet, mm-hmm. that's fine. But I think it would be interesting at this point to understand where people are at
yeah.
on those two questions that we need to report back to the city council.
And just for clarity, the pursuit of community power means the aggregation of just for the general public, they may not understand what community power means. So it's the aggregation. Voting to or recommend aggregating all power that is not currently third party power in the city.
Yes.
I don't want to take away. Well,
yeah. No, I'm just clarifying just to use the statement.
Definition. To me, and then I'm sorry.
No.
Our committee's recommendation to the city and city council, if we say yes, we should pursue community power. That to me is in the form of an energy advisory committee being stood back up in January in the new council term and a public process
yeah.
that involves us yeah. looking at all the steps and paperwork to do that so that you have those meetings and the documentation, joint powers, and all that kind of stuff to do that.
Yes. Yeah. Well, right. A lot of that's by statute, but the logical next steps are, yes. Public engagement, public meetings, explaining, surveys, draft energy plan of how to do it, more public feedback on that.
Right. Right. So it's not necessarily, we're not saying to commit everybody that we're doing it, but we would recommend we should go down that path and see benefits to it.
Right. I guess what I was just pointing out was just what it meant when you say community power. What does it mean?
Yep.
It means, you know, moving towards aggregating the power, which will give all the benefits that you just pointed out.
Yeah. So I guess, can I take a review then on answering those two questions?
Yes.
So yes, I agree with Portsmouth having community power. And second, I would also advocate for us joining to do that, the coalition. It would be a yes, yes. And the coalition would be for all the membership benefits, for the risk management, and then the oversight and the advocacy.
Okay. And hang on to those pitfalls.
Yep.
And areas of concern. This is how Cliff keeps meetings going.
I should have just started with that.
That's okay. That's okay. Peter, go ahead.
Yes. Yeah, thank you. So up front, I would say I too agree this city should do this, to go ahead with community power. And at this point, I am also a supporter of the coalition model. But let me give it a little more of a perspective from my situation in Concord. Number one, the current situation that allows us to do community power was based on a several bills over the last 2 years. And the most recent bill, HB 315, as it was submitted, was almost a bill to kill community power. And the people who saved it from being killed were essentially Cliff Below and some of the allies who are already doing this stuff, because they're saying, we have all these people lined up wanting to do this. You can't just kill this. We just had a bill last year. We just heard the rules several months ago, and now you want to kill it. So it just pointed out to me that this is a precarious situation. You cannot assume that we will have the authority as a municipality to continue to do this forever. There are groups that want to limit it or stop it entirely. And so for that one reason alone, it would be important to have strength in numbers. So being one town and trying to keep this thing going when the people in Concord are obstructing it would be very difficult to do. The minute you have a great large entity like the coalition, now they have the numbers and they have the clout to say, no, you can't stop this now. You can maybe limit it, you can change it, but you can't stop it. And I think Portsmouth, and I've heard this a couple of times mentioned from other people, that people want to see our town take some bold steps instead of taking small steps. And I know Bob Hayden very well. He's a great guy. He's a smart guy. I like to hear him all the time. He knows what he's doing. But he's one person, and he's one company, and they're doing a good job with their keen clients. However, and he comes and aggressively defends those clients all the time, but I would feel a lot more comfortable if we are part of a coalition, and in particular because of Cliff Below and the Henry Hearn and these others, and particularly Cliff. Cliff was a public utilities commissioner. He was a state senator. He is now the assistant mayor in Lebanon. And Lebanon has been doing all kinds of forward-thinking things all the time on their own, and sometimes waiting for the rules to allow them to do more. And I think the coalition model gives us a lot of room to pursue other kinds of services besides just getting the electric rate right or better. So I think we have more flexibility with the coalition. We have more clout, both financially, to go out and get good rates. But we have more political clout to make sure that our program won't be shut down anytime soon. And we also have a group of people who I trust personally as being competent enough to know how to do this. So all those things give me confidence to say, you know, and I do have concerns too. And I think Peter Russ has raised a couple of them in the past, rightfully when it comes to the financial issues. I think those are all things we need to clarify. So it's not a done deal just because we say that's a better model than broker model is. We need to deal with those. But I think those are things we can deal with and we must deal with in the process of getting the city's residents interested and supportive of these models. So that's pretty much all I have to say.
Oh, that's great. Great. And the legislative perspective is really valuable. Okay.
Can I just clarify, Peter, something I said before, that I was talking generally about the broker model, not talking specifically about there being any transparency issues with Good Energy or Standard Power.
Right.
I just was talking quite generally. So I just wanted
I understand.
Okay, good.
and Bob's a really straight shooter, so.
Yeah. Absolutely. I didn't want to be misconstrued.
No, I understand.
Sure. Can I first ask a clarifying question? What's the form of our report to the council? A verbal report? Is it something written?
We had a written report and then a verbal report back.
So a written report. Okay. I put together an outline thinking that there might be a written report at some point. And maybe this just helps explain my thinking, where I organized my thinking. To cut to the chase, I'm in support of recommending continuing to pursue community power. I'm a not quite yet on the coalition. Here's my thing. So I think that community power at its simplest form is a method for us to aggregate the buying power of the city, citizens of the city. I think that there are existing mechanisms in place that allow people to take control over their energy supply, but for a handful of very good reasons, it's not really getting the level of penetration that we're going to need to start decarbonizing our economy and make the clean energy goals we need. I think that community power gives us an opportunity to empower our citizens to be able to make more progress on that front. And for that reason alone, I think that we should recommend to the council that we continue this process. I think there's a good thing going there. Whether we get into a broker model or a portfolio manager model, I think that there's a lot of questions that would be important to understand better. I think there's more work to be done in terms of public education, public engagement. I understood from Councillor Lazenby's description that would be part of any future process should we succeed in moving forward with continuing to explore this. So I think that's great. Personally, I'm kind of, an early adopter and I'm all on board, but I feel an important fiduciary responsibility here. There's lots of money at stake. And whenever you're dealing with something like, hey, we're going to move everyone in the city onto a new energy supply, every single person in the city that pays an electric bill will be impacted by this. So I really just want to be mindful and conscientious about what that means. And I think that we saw a model that had several choices. I think that's great. Giving people choices is great, including choice to opt out. I understand the broker model well. I get how it works just through my work. I think that the way that it tries to support clean energy is through the purchase of renewable energy certificates, which is nice, but you don't know where those certificates are coming from. And if you wanted to do something a little bit more local, that may not be enough. So what we've seen in the industry is an evolution towards entering into contracts directly with resources. And that then you really are supporting clean energy more than just buying the attributes from a facility that's eligible. And I think that to the extent that the portfolio manager model allows us to do things like directly contracting with clean and renewable energy sources, I think that that's attractive and it's something that we should continue to look into. I am not quite sure that we can have both cost reduction and progress on clean energy, just my understanding of the economics of it. That would be great if possible, but to the extent that we can get some public engagement, maybe we can have a strategy or a plan that allows us to pursue both or pursue options that are a little bit more weighted towards one than the other. And that way we can try and make more people happy than fewer. You can never make everyone. So I think that there's a good idea here, but when you get to the coalition, I like Cliff. I think Cliff's great. I used to advise Cliff. I would love to see him succeed here, but the regulations aren't done. The entity hasn't been stood up, and developing a portfolio of contracts is a very serious business. It's, you have to be very careful with that. And the regulatory risk associated with the regulations aren't even done. We just saw the new PUC cut the legs off of energy efficiency. That concerns me. So I think it would be worthwhile and useful for us to continue pushing this forward, learning more, getting the community on board, fleshing out what some of the contours might be, and hopefully the PUC is able to do the promulgation of the regulations, the community, the coalition is able to stand itself up, become a little bit more mature in what it's doing. And you know, as I understand it, there are opportunities to join the coalition at another time. I think Mr. Sumsich makes a good point about time being important and strength in numbers being important. I just would want to make sure that the citizens of Portsmouth are on board with that strategy before, you know, endorsing that as so that's probably enough for now, but you know, just wanted to share my initial.
Yeah, I think you're highlighting some areas that have risk for us. I mean, we're, as a municipality, you're saying we have to be careful about our fiduciary role. Making us becoming a default supplier has a big impact on our supply. Regulations are not done yet. And the work of creating a an energy portfolio is pretty serious stuff. Start up aspirations. So I think that's all. Those are all important points. Good.
Sure. Ben, thank you for the outline. And I think it's, you're hitting most of the right things we need to cover. I think it's probably worth us talking about how in depth we would flesh this out in written form.
Oh, of course.
Mixed with, you know, the realities of the time and moving steps forward. But I think we really covered a lot of here. Although one piece I would want to perhaps a bullet point I might add on your Community Power Coalition section, which to me is important in the way I look at the difference between a coalition option and the broker option, is that I think there are aspects to that coalition that are beyond them being portfolio managers, right? So, they, I mean, or I suppose you could look at a portfolio manager as having, you know, more leverage in a sense, but I think that this coalition represents a, you know, there's a political coalition that is valuable in our state, valuable in Concord. You know, that for state legislation, it's valuable, I think, even regionally lubricate the wheels of projects for creative power that I don't think are there for the broker model. And I don't think they may necessarily be characteristic of portfolio management option that isn't of the nature of this coalition. That makes sense. The only other, you know, little difference on one thing you said, because you said a lot of great things, is I think it's important to encourage that. I don't think the options are seeking lower cost power or greener power. I think there's the option of getting lower cost greener power, right? And that to me, I'm moved by, you know, more transformative
pursuit of greener power, and I think we can do it for cheaper through the coalition model than if we're not with a coalition, if we do it on our own or through the broker model. I also think there's probably a good chance for some of the less greener power to be a little cheaper through that bargaining power, but I do think the greener power can be cheaper than it. That to me is an appeal. I would support, I certainly think we should recommend to the council that the community move forward further towards pursuit of community power. I think we should recommend that the mayor-elect stand back up the Energy Advisory Committee in the new council period. And with the help of the Energy Advisory Committee, start the procedures and public process to get the community to understand in more depth what that means. That would be one thing I think should be part of our recommendation. And then I do think we should join the coalition sooner. I think we should recommend to the council to join the coalition sooner for a number of reasons. I'm not sure where I see the downside of joining the coalition. And I'm not trying to be, over dramatic. But we're not going to commit money. We're not going to commit to even buy power. We're going to commit to be part of that group to try and help shape or finish shaping. They've done a lot of shaping. They're getting close. They're not all the way there, but they're making a lot of progress. And I think we have a chance to be at that table helping to finish how that shaped and strengthen what comes out of it. And that path to me, that the coalition, the Community Power Coalition in New Hampshire, is the best path that I think Portsmouth has towards transformative change for greener power in our community. And so that's it. I think we should get involved. I see low risk, I see high upside. Both from their model, but also from us being involved. I think we help, build the leverage. We can help build the leverage that they can't have. And if when it gets down to it, and they're ready to have options available for people's power supply, we have a chance to change gears. So I a couple other notes on that. I was more impressed the more we talked with coalition folks, especially that last meeting, Samuel Golden and April West and all that group, that they thought they'd done a lot of thinking through on this and a lot of progress on it, and that it wasn't, they weren't building a brand new wheel. They were putting in a wheel that had been used in other places and even at a similar scale. When we talked about California before, it was, they're not doing a big, huge California statewide. They may have a bunch of things the size of the coalition of New Hampshire. And I feel like they have a good number of safeguards in place for some of the, risks or pitfalls they might have in standing up their startup. So I felt very impressed, by the people that they have on board and how committed they are to this. And that made me feel, in the summer when we were talking on the council, I was a little more cautious about the speed to join the coalition. Well, let's look further in community power first. Let's let them write. But, and I've come around to the point where I think it would help Portsmouth and the coalition for us to be well sooner.
Great. Thank you.
So I would follow along on question number one, join community power, absolutely keep things moving in that direction. And thanks, Ben. This is really nice to look at and an outline. I'm also leaning, I have a few kind of identical thoughts that Cliff just shared. And mostly I think I look at joining sooner than later, low risk, and when we join, we get a seat at the table. And so I agree, Ben, with the, you know, caution about a portfolio model. And that may not be as tried and true, although, like you were just mentioning, but there's a fair amount of community power that's been around for a fairly long time in California. But I think the benefits to me, you know, we talk about, and as I understand, we would have low, we with the coalition, we'd have lower cost power that wouldn't necessarily be green. I mean, we can decide what we want to do, but we can offer both low cost non-green power and green power. It's kind of, it's up to us, but we can, you know, pull the city and decide which options we want to offer. But it seems, the way I see it, that the benefits to the coalition are compounded initially from what Peter was saying, where we really, I mean, I think at our first meeting, I was commenting at the lack of leadership in the state around clean energy, and it's gotten worse. And it continues to be moving in the wrong direction. And this just seems like a potential, maybe, you know, to begin with a small way, but a way to help us move in the right direction. Things like community power going away, or like the efficiency programs going away. I think, you know, down the road, if we become, you know, a couple of years down the road, we potentially are filling some of the gaps that's not there at the state level. I know in looking at having some discussions around the infrastructure bill, a group like a community power can look for grants from infrastructure money and get that, and potentially will, and then look at clean energy and other things coming out of that organization as a nonprofit, as a community aggregator. So yeah, I think the compounded benefits, I think John, you may have mentioned the city doing something a little, you know, on the more bold front. And I see the coalition as kind of a, making a bit of a statement and adding every town that joins, I think adds a little more credibility, adds a little more clout to the group. And, you know, I think that's a great thing. I'd be proud to say, you know, Portsmouth is adding to this organization. And I think we do that at very little risk. And I think now, once we're there, we're at the table, we can really keep a close eye on how things are moving. And by the time summer comes around or fall, and, you know, we can make a different decision at that point, but we've had a bird's eye view along the way. And I think we've helped the coalition move in the right direction by being there and adding on to the group. So I think that was most of the things that I was thinking of. And I guess the final thought was, portfolio manager, the coalition being fairly new in the state, we also have the situation of, like, Keene being up front with a broker model, still not up and running, though. So we don't really have any, we can't point to anything that's really working well. It's all, you know, a bit of a risk. It's all a bit of a work in progress. And I just think the benefits are so much stronger moving in the coalition direction. That's the way I would recommend.
Great. I think, as you say, having a seat at the table in the process. So, and we are, as a state, moving in the wrong direction. So, to the extent that Portsmouth can help, we're in or in the water. That's Kevin?
Good evening. You can hear me okay, Councilor?
Yep.
Sorry, I'm not there in person. So I'm maybe a little bit of a hybrid here with the discussion. I fully support aggregation and for the goals that we're talking about, more options, potential green. So I'm fully on board with aggregation. And my take on this is, I think we have an opportunity to commit to the coalition and have that seat at the table by signing the joint powers agreement, and, you know, to have membership on the board and be fully engaged and be in a position to, you know, have the sharing among the communities, stay on top of the regulatory and legislative developments. But keeping our options open in terms of how we want to move forward. I don't think there's any risk, there's any cost at all to signing the JPA and becoming a member and being fully engaged with the coalition, help them develop. They're very much in their infancy. I've been impressed with what they've had to say. They've done their homework, absolutely, but they're very much at the starting gate, and it's a complex organizational structure they're putting in place. They have a lot of work to do before, you know, their launch date in June. And I don't see any risk at all. In fact, there's a lot of benefit for Portsmouth to be at the table and to be a member through the JPA at this point in time. And now, from my experience in running large projects in my career, I always like to be a fast follower as opposed to being on the bleeding edge. And I think we can be engaged. We can support the coalition, certainly have every hope that they're going to be successful. But I think we can move cautiously and let things play out in 2022 and see when we want to move forward to that next phase in terms of how do we want to secure our power. You know, perhaps it is through the coalition. And I think that would be wonderful if the coalition, you know, takes shape to the point that as a committee, as a city council, as the residents in the town, we think that's the direction that we want to head. But I don't think it's a binary decision at this point in terms of joining the coalition, and that's the end all. I think we can take a phase one step to participate with every hope that they're going to be successful, but keeping our options open in terms of how we want to move forward and let things play out a little bit. And then move to phase two. We can be working on our on an implementation plan. We can be working on resident education, and move things down the field. It wouldn't be that we'd be stopping, but I think we have the opportunity to join and then continue to work on our plan and work on what is vitally important around education with our residents over the first part of 2022. And then hopefully we do make a decision to join the coalition if everyone's comfortable doing so. So, Councilor, I think that's kind of my take. I do have concerns and considerations, but I'll pause there.
Great. Okay. I'll call on myself, and then I'll call on Peter here to get there as well. In terms of moving ahead with community power, the status quo was, as Becca says, is not going to move us to decarbonization very fast at all. And I think we can by aggregation. We've seen success with the aggregation model driving decarbonization. The Marin County example really impresses me. 5 years, they got to 50%. I also think long-term greener power will be cheaper power, but it's gonna take a while to get there, perhaps. And I think, we empower our residents, as Becca said. We're freeing them from the utility default and giving them a much more sophisticated set of options. So I think for those reasons, there's just much more to gain by moving towards community power. I like Standard Power's presentation. It's simple, it's pretty clean and easy. They hold your hand. I really like the customer engagement part, the survey and the menu of options they developed out of that. And we should just take that piece and do it ourselves. And it's a political quick win. But I don't think you're locked into longer term contracts. I think that drives a little bit of a pricing premium. And I would be concerned that we would bounce above and below the default rate if we were using brokers. So for that reason, I like the CPCNH better. I think the portfolio method took a while to to understand it. I still don't fully understand it, I'll confess, but I think there's more diversification of energy sources. There's more active management, both in the spot market and contracts, and the ability to buy direct. CPC Energy's portfolio, people buying renewables directly, I think is really powerful because drive will create a market in the state that we can then sell to our residents. And that excites me. It is proven. California, you know, it's interesting to me that California, everybody had tried the broker model. They had the scale to go to portfolio when they did it. They saw a case of up in the Redwoods area, very rapid implementation once they had their portfolio manager. So that and sharing the cost to the expertise among all the cities and towns, the political clout is absolutely important. I think CPCNH's goals align with our goals. We want to have renewable power. We want to have something we can offer our residents. It gives them a number of options. CPCNH is a nonprofit that exists for the benefit of municipalities and our community power programs. So the goals align. Opposed to a for-profit company. So I think we get better energy purchasing. A nonprofit with a portfolio would be able to drive more renewable purchasing directly. And the political clout can't be ignored. And our ability to shape CPC really is exciting. And I think we could be a good voice. Okay. So for those reasons, yes, I think we should recommend pursuing community power because the status quo will not get us to a greener future. Community power can do so quickly. Yes, I think we should join CPCNH because it's low risk, high reward, gets us a seat at the table, we can help shape it. And, you know, we don't have to do this tomorrow. We can watch them put this together, participate. I also really like the democratic open governance of CPCN. Having watched one of their board meetings, they're really listening to all their committees. So that's where I'm at. Peter?
You want
to go first? I just said Peter.
Yeah.
Peter,
he is the Peter. You know, as an advisory position that I'm in here, I'm comfortable with the direction you all are going. I think aggregating power does give the community options to influence the market and to help speed things up. I get cautious though when I hear a lot of grand promises, and I would not lead necessarily with all the promises about what we can do. More so, I think the leverage that you get by being part of a larger coalition makes a lot of sense. You don't have to be a power purchaser. You can be a non-power purchasing member of that coalition, which gives you a lot of flexibility, like you all have said, and it helps provide that additional gentle hand on the back of the various legislators that are deciding that they, you know, want to dismantle all the progress that's been made, the little progress that's been made. The the reasons why I'm comfortable, you know, with this are a number, and they really, they're consistent with the city's eco-municipality, the council policies relative to sustainability, the natural steps process that we've committed to for over 13 plus years. So these are all things that are consistent with the city's ethic and what we stand for. So I think it's a very positive statement to be made. The challenge is really, you know, as Becca was saying, it's like some of the get quickly into the weeds. There are many concerns that I have about managing, you know, one, hiring a portfolio manager, and then managing your portfolio managers. These people make a lot of money, and they're not, you know, even at a scale that we're talking about, they're not necessarily going to be the only client for this entity. And it's one of those things that you need to go. It's not all kumbaya. These people are in for money, and you know, yes, they may be able to enable our ability to do what we want to do. But you know, portfolio management is a very risky business, and it's something that has to be you know, analyzed very, very much. And gentlemen, that, you know, all you guys that have worked in the industry, I'm not telling you anything new. So my little experience with power procurement has made me very much aware that there are AAA rated power suppliers, and there are, you know, fly by night power suppliers, and a portfolio manager evaluates those different types of risk. And the more you expand to local power procurement, the higher your risk or power generation, the higher the risk. So, you know, with risk, there's costs. And so you quickly get into the weeds, as I was just saying. So I understand, and I agree with the direction that the committee is going in. I think it's the right thing to do. I think getting the city council on board and having a vigorous discussion with the public is really, you know, the next real important step. And I look forward to that process. I think it's definitely is going to help speed things up.
I think I'll go off the last thing Peter just said, kind of speeding things up. You know, I come here, you know, as the environmental planner and sustainability coordinator, and work with the sustainability committee, and their charge has been urgency. You know, there's not a lot of time to make a change in terms of what's going on. I think the coalition, community power, obviously, to me, makes a lot of sense, as everyone here has said. I really appreciate all the work everybody has put in terms of how deliberate everyone is, how much understanding people have in the industry, and how much homework everyone's done. So that's really impressive. And it kind of fits with Portsmouth. I think the way that this committee has approached this has been a really appropriate approach. I mean, some communities just dove right in, and we're going to see what happens. But people are really looking at this and making a lot of sense of it. To me, it makes a lot of sense from the fact that we're in New Hampshire, and it's a coalition that's going to be a nonprofit that we're talking about next after Community Power. Or a model where you go to the broker, or you aggregate with some entity that you may or may not know much about. I feel like there's a lot more at stake for the coalition that's represented by communities around New Hampshire. I feel like Peter's point about the legislature is a huge point, because not only do we want to support the coalition if that goes forward for the city, but I think the coalition support in Concord is going to be necessary to keep, you know, to protect green energy, decarbonization, efficiency, all those things that aren't just going to be, you have to support these communities that are doing this, but you have to support energy efficiency throughout the state when we go more to decarbonization. So for me, it goes back to the urgency thing. I do think it makes sense to join the coalition. I probably feel like I know enough already, not that I'm by any means an expert, to even start looking at what the rates would be to buy power when they get up and running, and think about joining soon, you know, activating sooner than later in terms of the transfer over. But I get what Ben's saying, it's very complicated, and you want to make sure it's going to work. So I think that makes sense too. Much different than a lot of people, but I'm just pulling the urgency piece in terms of why I look at it.
Just want to add a couple of comments based on what I just heard from various people. One of the problems we have in New Hampshire right now, and maybe it's transitory, maybe it isn't, is that we don't really encourage renewable energy in this state much as a state government. And that means it's very hard for us to get those renewable energy sources to be part of our supply needs right now, because actually businesses are looking elsewhere. We are in New England, we're definitely at the bottom of almost every category, renewable energy, energy efficiency, all these things. And so right now we are kind of dependent on the trading of renewable energy certificates as a way of encouraging renewable energy throughout the New England region and nationally. But ultimately we'd like to be buying more directly from the sources. And perhaps when we have offshore wind here in New Hampshire, maybe that's an opportunity for us to get involved in that. Secondly, I think the it was encouraging for me to hear from April Salas last time about the fact that they're approaching, Hanover is approaching Dartmouth College as being a partner in this aggregation. I mean, Dartmouth College is a huge institution. I think many, because of the number of the members of the coalition, all these members, even Nashua and others, will be reaching out to interested parties in their area who want to be part of this. So it's not just going to be a municipality. If other businesses or organizations want to be part of this, the more communities reach out, the more this coalition is going to grow, which is really also very important. And finally, to what Peter Bricks just mentioned about the environmental issues. I'm going tomorrow to speak to the high school ecology club because I read the article that most of you read in the paper about their climate distress. Young people are so distressful about the future, especially about climate change, that they decide that maybe we shouldn't have a family, maybe I shouldn't have children. We're doomed. So I'm going there to try to talk them off the ledge because I think there are lots of opportunities for them to get engaged. And I think something like this locally is something that they might be latching on to, say, well, how can we participate in a step program like this? Anyway.
So I'm hearing a pretty good consensus to, yes, move ahead with community power, join the coalition, but be aware of the risks, particularly the complexity of portfolio management. Maybe we should take some time to tease out the other areas we should be cautious. Okay. You were saying you're not fully sold yet. Tom, you were saying. Kevin, you were saying this is...
Yeah, sorry, I was on mute. I'm not in the camp of moving ahead with the coalition in its entirety. I'm in the camp, maybe by myself, of joining via the Joint Powers Agreement and being a member at the table for where the council is right now and supporting their efforts 110%. But in terms of moving all the way through to a cost-sharing agreement and procuring our power through the coalition, I'm not there yet. I just wanted to, a little nuance there. When we say join the coalition, that means different things to me than just, that's the end all direction. I'm all on board with moving to the first phase of joining the coalition.
Yeah, I mean, maybe we should break it down into. Do we want to go with community power as an undertaking of the city as opposed to the status quo? Then if we do that, how do we do that? And we can either use a broker or we can use CPCNH when it comes time to purchase. But I think you've done something smart, which is separate joining CPCNH from making them our power supply.
Yeah, I think in the meantime, while we're considering our power source a little bit down the road, and I agree there's urgency and we should move as quickly as we can, but I think in the interim, there's absolutely no risk or downside with fully supporting the coalition and their objectives.
Yeah, and I think the coalition would tell you there'll be a first wave,
which they hope will be summer or fall of next year. Whether or not we join the first wave can be independent of us being a member of the coalition.
Right. Yes, exactly. Thank you.
John. So, Kevin, I think that what you just said, that distinction makes a lot of good sense. I wanted to point people towards, on the CPCNH website, there's a, you know, they have a flow chart that they call the roadmap to community power. And I think it's very similar to what Kevin just described, actually. You know, where if you pull it up, either, it's cpcnh.org/members. It'll show you from roadmap to members and then roadmap right there. So that, I feel like that chart, and we'll see here shortly, kind of fits with what some bit of what Kevin described, as well as what makes sense to me. And click that link one more time, the link that said roadmap. There you go. Scroll down just a little bit more. That's it right there. So, you know, and Kevin, I don't know if you see this, but there's a lot about, you know, joining the coalition and then the steps that we need to do in the city of Portsmouth, an aggregation committee, information, goals, data, aggregation plan, public hearings, and then some adoption of, you know, what we end up with by the city council. So I think that, to me, so I would support recommending this, right? So to maybe cut to the chase.
Just add something to this clip. I had printed this out a couple of weeks ago, and I made a note that is it Nate, Matt from Durham?
Nate.
He said that right now Durham is in that collect data and set goals stage. So, and just to second the fact that we can do both of these things in tandem. We can form an electric. We want to move towards aggregation.
Yeah.
But we can form a committee whilst also being part of the coalition and part of that knowledge gathering track. So these things can happen at the same time.
Yeah. I would support us recommending that. And I would certainly echo what Peter Bridge was saying in terms of urgency and getting things moving. But I also think there's a fairly low risk to that step of joining the coalition when we do the other things. I also want to think about the outline that Ben provided us, which is really good. And some of it feels like the guts of what you really start that aggregation committee work with, right? So it's not off base to say this is what we looked at and thought about in this committee's meetings. I think following through on the depths of all this and a report in a couple of weeks is a tall order, you know, right? It'd be a lot to ask, and it'd be a lot for the council to consume. And, you know, frankly, we're going to be wrapping up as a council. I think it makes sense for the, you know, if we're going to dig in as a community, let's dig in, right? And so I wonder whether, you know, even, you know, some version of this, you know, maybe there's recommendations, maybe there's we're providing the council with a recap of, you know, what we covered in summary, and then this can also provide some bit of blueprint for where the next phase of the committee will go, rather than necessarily fleshing these bullet points out in a more.
That was just a means to organize my
thing. No, but it's really good. That's what, like, you know, I think it's really valuable.
Yeah.
To preserve it, use it, you can present it to people on the kind of things that we're looking at. And
not necessarily have it have the pressure of fleshing it out further, but it's also a way to show a path forward.
That's a human belief.
Because otherwise, man, I think we're looking at you to help write.
Well, there's also, you know, a two-step process where we'd recommend pursuing community power in the coalition at the next, at the 20th, December 20th. But then, and then we'd recommend, as you say, Cliff, renewing PI, renewing this community to do the work. And then first quarter next year, second quarter next year, we start to work on what it would take to build out. Because we will need a vote at some point from the new council to say, let's develop a community power plan. I think that's what this full report, this is the full report that we give to the new council, say, March, April, whatever. Here's the whole rationale for what we recommend in the fall. And here's how we would go about it. If there's some elements we're still going to wait to commit to, that's fine.
I would not envision us on the 20th having the joint powers agreement in the council packet or having a motion for us to sign. I think that right. I think that's premature for the December 20th.
Yes, and I think we'd have an easier time with it.
Well, right, and I think it's just also it's a fit to give it enough of that time,
right.
And but we can still make that recommendation to form the committee, and even recommend that, you know, I would recommend it was in the first quarter. You know, first quarter that. Council brings forth that joint powers agreement and considers doing a coalition balancing
right. Right.
Like focus.
John, can I just add one comment? And basically, looking at this draft that Kevin gave us, I look at this, the community power idea, not as just aggregation of electricity, but aggregation of energy consumption. This could be more than just electricity. I mean, we're starting with electricity because that's like the easiest target right now. But it could be a whole bunch of other things, including energy services like energy efficiency measures. You know, these could be all part of this that would be offered to people, residents in Portsmouth. So it's not just electricity necessarily.
I think that's a question we've been asked. The new year should be energy advisory.
Cool. I'm sure the coalition is going to be looking at kind of things.
Yeah.
But does that make sense in terms of when we do this whole report? I don't want to, this is really I mean, this gives us a framework to put all our work together. But I think what we want for the 20th is Cliff said, is
We don't have another meeting scheduled in this committee next time. Oh, we do. Oh, okay, good.
Well, we could have two two-page or something like that.
So review for me again with the ask that the city council will be on December 20th, just so I have it in mind.
I don't know if we're asking.
We're asking.
I think we're reporting.
Just reporting.
So that's, so I don't think we're looking for a motion per se, right? Or an action. From that night, I think we are making recommendations. We're reporting back what we've done.
Yep.
We're making two recommendations that we're asking for that. Giving some background on what goes on. And The forming committee is a big part of but the next stage of the committee. It's mm-hmm. part of the
reinstatement of
Well that's what we meant.
Yeah.
So reforming the energy budget so that we can I don't think it would be terrible to consider using that flow chart at CPCNH.
Mm-hmm.
I think that would be illustrative of some of what we're talking about. People are up for it. Maybe on the 13th, can we be looking at a draft of what we'd submit?
So extending the committee wouldn't come up on the 20th?
Or the mayor elects would come up with it. It would, because those things end with the council term.
But so, I could certainly be talking to the mayor elect about that.
Yeah.
Okay.
Does the sustainability committee terminate with the mayor's term as well?
Theoretically, all the committees do, but the sustainability committee started, I think, 2006 or 2005. And every mayor has elected to continue it. So they don't all stop, but they all are at the pleasure of the mayor.
They're all welcome to those
meetings. That sounds great. I guess my question is, would it make sense to make a recommendation to have a slightly more permanent committee? If you're going to get into the portfolio management business, you don't know if the advisory board is going to exist in the next term. That seems risky. So I just wonder aloud, and you know, out of school here, no problem. But would one of the things that we would consider recommending to the council be, hey, to do something like this, you're going to need something a little bit more permanent than just
so maybe something that you the timing may not be appropriate to roll it out immediately.
Sure.
You know, it may be self-evident once you get into the process, and you know, I think there's going to be a long educational process for people and bring them up to speed. You know, it's a really good point. I think as you get into the solid recommendations, you can say, okay, in order, if we're moving down this path, in order to do that, we would recommend you make permanent ordinance-driven committee that allows for continuity and level of comfort for anybody that we're entering agreements with to know that it's going to be a standing committee or however it's structured. But I think if you lead out with that, you may end up taking the wind out of the whole discussion, and it'll all become, you know, do we need this permit, do we not? And so I would roll it out organically.
Sounds great. I just feel like I've seen there's a misalignment between the life cycle of a politician energy.
your point is well taken,
but you know,
that's part of the problem where we're not getting far enough.
Yeah, and if one of our big steps is to go out and engage the community, get a survey, and if, for example, people say, if I can get more green power at the same rate as I would kill it, I want to do it. Other people, we have a lot of people say, I want to buy 100%. Then I think the predicate to that is we're going to need an energy committee that can see that through for the long term. That's the desire of the residents. I think that gives you the platform to say, this is what the residents want. We'll need an ordinance driven permanent.
Just a thought.
Yeah, no, it's a good question, and I think it emphasizes to me the importance of this ribbon committee. Then come back and say, well, look at the task they've set for us. So if it's permanent, it needs to be created by ordinance, which means for second, third reading, public hearing. So that can be a 2 or 3 month process. Cliff, I like your idea of. Let's use the
think there's consensus about that.
Yeah, is everybody?
Can I clarify my statements before?
Yeah.
I had conflated joining the coalition with buying power.
Yeah.
I'm hearing a distinction. This flow chart is very helpful in you know, showing the contours of that distinction. So just want to clarify that I think supporting the coalition, helping shape it, providing additional support at the state and local level, I think those are all good ideas. And if there truly is no financial risk associated with that, I too am on board. So I think there would be consensus in that.
Yeah, and I think the great part, whether we buy power from them 22 or 23, great part. Your point, Becca, about the shared learning. We're in the whole of energy management. We're all learning together. Not just from other towns and cities in New Hampshire, but the experience of other coalitions, California, Massachusetts. It's advanced. They're 5 years, 6 years.
And I think they also pointed to the VPSA entity in Vermont. Vermont Public Power Supply. I'm not sure what the A stands for. That's also an interesting model that has similarities to the coalition that we may want to work with. And a guy that used to do a lot of the power procurement at VPSA is now at the co-op. So perhaps we can get Brian Callan on the phone to ask him what he thinks.
And Councilor Tabor, I don't think we did get a good answer. You know, we do have Massachusetts in our backyard, and with 150 towns that have aggregated, and since 2016, they could have formed a coalition, and they haven't. So, you know, we really don't know why. So I think we just need to tread a little bit lightly on using the California example. I'm reluctant to put a whole lot of emphasis in what has happened in California. And I just think we need to be a little bit careful in terms of right in our backyard, you know, 30 miles away, we have communities that have aggregated and have not found the benefit for whatever reason to form a coalition. So I think we just, you know, I just want to not get too far out on the diving board with the California model when it has not been adopted in Massachusetts, other than the Cape, which has been around for 20 years.
Right.
I'm not trying to throw, you know, a wet blanket. I'm just trying to be sensitive to right in our backyard. We have all 150 towns that have aggregated and have not, there has not been any push to form a coalition to take advantages of all these benefits that the New Hampshire coalition is touting. And I haven't been able to connect the dots yet as to why.
Just be the shaky legs legislatively that we're on here in New Hampshire versus in Massachusetts.
You know, I think, Kevin, you raise a really good point that each state is kind of uniquely different. You mentioned what's happening in Massachusetts, and it's totally correct. However, on the other hand, Massachusetts is the leader in energy efficiency in the whole country. So why aren't we anywhere near there? Because we live in New Hampshire. So there are very specific differences between the states, and they have to do with a lot of the state's emphasis on things and the financial incentives available. And certainly, I mean, all the incentives available for energy efficiency in Massachusetts are enormous compared to what we're seeing right now in New Hampshire. So I think your comment is good for us to keep in mind that we have to be cautious about extrapolating one state's experience to the other.
Yeah, I think you make a great point. I think they have arrived at a place where we're trying to get to through other means. Yeah. And perhaps the coalition is what we need in New Hampshire to jumpstart to get there. You raise a very good point. But just if we get that question, I think we need to have those answers in our back pocket.
Just on that, and Kevin, I agree. I think it's worth bringing up that difference, although I don't. I mean, I thought Sam McGoling had some, you know, compelling response to that question, you know, talking about how far along entrenched, you know, communities already were and what they were doing. And it's going to be hard to get people to change at all. And they may have less incentive about changing what they're doing, rather continuing something they're already doing versus where we're at, where we haven't started anything yet and we're deciding which road to take.
Yeah, but we're talking about the buying power. We're touting the buying power as being a real positive. And just think of the buying power that Massachusetts could get by pulling those towns together, and they have, for whatever reason, have not. That's I've just, you know, it's just in the back of my mind, I keep kind of wondering why, but you know.
No, I think it's fair. I just think I guess I don't think we're without some viable explanation as to why it hasn't moved or hasn't moved as quickly, and some of that has to do with, you know, the stasis of you know, government action sometimes, right? And there's some well entrenched you know, people are interested in them not doing that too. So I don't think it's just clearly an example that the appeal isn't there. I guess I would say that. I would caution from saying that Massachusetts, you know, proves that the model may not have the appeal or the benefits. I don't think that's completely fair conclusion.
Yeah, I think Peter's points before were right on target. I think they have arrived at a better place through other means.
Yeah.
Kevin, I might speculate that they have a whole lot of towns that have gone full municipal in Massachusetts, and they have banded together as one eco. So maybe some of the towns that would have adopted, you know, the coalition kind of approach that we're talking about have already gone so far to buy pipes and wires. And they are aggregating with one eco and CMEC in Connecticut. So maybe that's a counterpoint. I just don't know.
Yep.
Impressed by you've been on that question, Kevin. Put that in writing, and I thought it was a very good one. But why not? Why haven't we done that to your ground? But I thought April Salas gave us a pretty sensible answer too. She said, we tried it. He ended up feeling that a coalition was going to be the better approach. And Cliff and the others, other towns, set out to I think they found it's really hard work to be bidding your power as a community all the time, not knowing if you're going to give your residents a benefit. There's got to be a better way. I found her remarks that way.
I just wanted to also add the question we have for our own communities is, you know, what kind of risk are we undertaking? And I think one should not forget that there are entities in this coalition that are much larger than we are. They have much more risk, much more to lose than we do. Of course, we're responsible for our own municipalities and not for them. But you take a town like Nashua, and you know, that's a big risk for them. They're much bigger than we are. So to be aligned with these other communities gives us a little extra safety.
Yeah, I think very clearly portfolio management, standing that up is, that's a serious business. We have to be very cautious about our role with our residents and the economy. And that's the black box that the coalition has. We can't see it, we can't touch it. It's not there yet. But I'm not convinced that just going to the broker model, although it's simpler and easier, ambiguous on all those other values. I think we go with the coalition, but go cautiously with our eyes open. Watch how it develops and play a role. Okay, so what do you guys think the next steps are here on how do they
roll? Sorry, it's the little lawyer in me. I don't do that as much these days, but I feel like a document is helpful. I think that two pages is a good idea, but I would suggest that one of our next steps be getting something on paper that we can review and discuss and get comfortable with. I think bullets are fine, but I think two pages is a good next step.
All right, we'll shoot for the 13th for our meeting.
Yeah, do you think we could mix a little bit of our what we did with what's on this outline and bring a draft to the 13th? Is that
sense?
And then we can agree on it by the end of that meeting. And
in terms of staff helping us with that,
I feel fine about Peter helping with you. I was thinking a Google Doc or something like that.
Yeah,
some sort of common document that people just add to it.
I can use Google Docs, so I can use it, but I don't want to set it up and start.
I just do that as an example.
I can put something together from what I heard. If you guys want, we can email it around, and that might be a way to do it.
Sure.
Or I might do something, you know, to you, John, and then maybe you can send it to other people however you want.
Yeah.
Here, I can send to you what I sent to John a couple weeks ago, just organized my thoughts similar to what Ben had done, that fills in perhaps some of the introduction and background pieces, and then fills in a little bit about what are the benefits of the coalition, but there's some others in there about what's coming out. I know we don't want it to be too lengthy, but some content just to fill in.
Yeah.
I feel like this committee has gathered a lot of good information. I feel like we've gotten some really good presentations. Is there an ability for us, maybe the timing's not right yet, but is there an ability for us to share some of that information? Is there like a web page or something we can post the presentations to date so far?
Is it trying to be? We can create a web page with our other resources as well?
Mr. Golding had a wealth of information.
Mm-hmm.
And to the extent that there are folks that are interested in following up on this committee, you know, recommends to the council, jumpstart the process of public education.
So, if we could have a motion to have all of the presentations put on a energy advisory landing page on the website.
The page exists.
There's the page right now.
Yeah, the page exists and has all our YouTube
things.
It has the, and it can have more documents. What do we have that I read here? Yep. It's got one of the CPC.
It's out there.
So does that mean that someone didn't go out and buy the domain name ahead of time? Sorry. That's not even that true.
Typically, we put like resources with these types of things, so we can work with Stephanie Seward.
There's one there. We can add to it. Scroll down. It's document. A little further, right there.
Yeah,
that's one example of a resource.
Oh, there's a document.
So we can put more of that, the meeting videos in there.
Yeah, but I think if we vote a motion for that,
We could also include the ability for people to register so they can e-blast, email blast. And then that way, that's always good to keep, create that database of people who are interested in the So we can work on getting that done.
We have a motion to put presentations on the webpage and a sign up for email blast.
So moved.
Second.
Cool. Anyone in favor?
Aye.
And then our other action is we'll summarize tonight's discussion.
Can you forward this electronically to Peter so it's part of the minutes?
Yeah, I think right here. John, what you wrote down there, is that being recorded by?
Well, I'll take a picture of it.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. Now, do you want me to put that in the minutes then, or?
Do you want to put it in the minutes from what I emailed you?
Yeah,
it
could be.
And Peter, I could start a Google Doc for you and put that outline, because it is really nice rather than passing around a document as it is, to just go in and see.
It saves the redundancy.
Oh, I missed that last version.
Yeah, I didn't have the last, you know.
That'd be great. That'd be great. So, yeah. I think, you know, wouldn't know where to set it up that makes sense. So.
It would be helpful for me too. Thinking about this process of the next meeting, John, once we come to a place where we have this draft report. And that's why I was asking you to reiterate what the recommendations are at the next city council meeting. Because I'm already looking down the line. I don't mean to get in the weeds, but I'm already thinking about what the community's going to ask, what their objections are. And I'm telling you, you're going to have five people asking you that night, when are we going to have a solar array built? I'm already looking at I guess setting expectations of time, so it's helpful to hear, you know, perhaps by May or March or April we'll be thinking about joining the coalition or not, or we are starting this electric aggregation committee or community power. I think that's a little bit more all-inclusive, more comprehensive. So I'm already thinking about ways to questions that we might get that we don't have an answer for yet, and just kind of setting the community's expectations that we are going to be doing community outreach and stakeholder engagement. We want the community's feedback on this menu of choices and, you know, all of that. But yeah, I'm just worried about expectation setting, I guess. We do have some lofty goals, I think. We've said some bold statements, but.
Would it make sense? Within thinking in terms of our report back to the council, but for the web page, FAQ, when will we get local solar?
Yeah.
How do we move on to it? What is giving the council?
We feel the urgency too, but we need community power to get to.
Yes.
We can be all right as.
Yeah.
I'll let you know that tomorrow.
But you raise a good point.
It is. So this teenager from the Eco Club at our last sustainability committee was talking about people's concerns about the youngsters, you know, not being involved or being worried. His answer was the kids are all right. I thought it was a very, very clever way to bring the old people in and be like, hey, this kid gets it. Yeah, that's good.
Well, you know, I'm going there tomorrow because I was asked to do it, but it reminded me that there is a great guide from the Union of Concerned Scientists, which is the Consumer's Guide to Effective Environmental Consumerism. And what it does is it breaks down all the consumer habits or practices and how they impact our whole environment, not just greenhouse gases, air quality, water quality, habitat restoration, biodiversity. And it goes through a complete analysis of what's the important stuff, where can you make a difference, and where, don't sweat it, it's not that important.
Right.
Not that it isn't good to do something, but, you know, if you're going to put your effort into something, here are the top five things that are most impactful. And so I've kind of tailored my presentation to say, okay, let's look at what is the most impactful things to do based on this analysis. And you know, some of those things are not what people, what young people think they should be doing. And it's okay for them to do those things, but the analysis shows it doesn't make that much of an impact. Here are things that do make an impact. So I'm trying to get them focused in a direction with, and one of the things I mentioned in my presentation is the community power idea coming to Portsmouth in the near future, maybe. And here you can make an impact. So,
great.
So we've got what we're going to do next. We're going to make your drafted here. I want to thank everybody for being a lot of complexity. We have one of the strongest. Background and how serious we've taken this. It's time to inform our city council. Our city council is going to see a lot of great work.
Let's get back to where we left the lunch.
Hey, Kevin. Take care.
Yeah, we're talking about 40K,
oh, really?
Man. That's why we're
here.
Yeah, yeah.